Happy New Year and welcome to Weekends with Whitney. This morning, we focus our camera on a man made famous by his own. World-renowned wildlife photographer, C.C. Lockwood. His breathtaking pictures have exposed Louisiana's treasures and perils like nothing else. Plus, get ready to laugh. Lip Sync BR, why these folks pulled out all the stops and costumes to beat out the others and cancer at the same time. Then Dr. Nick gives us a reason to pause before getting lit up like the Christmas tree at your holiday parties. But first, we journey to photographer C.C. Lockwood's favorite place in Louisiana. And like him, it is wild and wondrous. This is one of C.C. Lockwood's finest hours. The hour surrounding sunset and sunrise. It's picture perfect. The sun started rising on his passion for photography early.
I got a brownie, Kodak brownie, when I was 6 for Christmas. And then I got a Kodak Instamatic about junior high and took a lot of camping and hiking and canoeing pictures.
The boy who'd spent 17 years in Fort Smith, Arkansas, had no idea then he'd spend the next 43 in Louisiana.
I was actually going to Arkansas from the third grade till April of 67. And two buddies of mine wanted to look at LSU, so my dad drove us down on an April weekend. I saw the campus, met the head of architecture school, and signed up that day.
Yes, architecture, not photography. He'd go on to change his major 4 times.
Switched to pre-med, and then I switched to accounting, and that was a little too indoors farming, so I switched to art, and I finally graduated in finance, all in 4 years.
And yet he never worked a day working in finance. He was bitten by the shutter bug his senior year, when he applied for a photographer job at the Reveille.
And he said, you have a camera? And I said, a Kodak Instamatic. I said, can you develop film? I said, no. He says, well, I don't believe we could hire you. So I went to the union, took the darkroom course, begged my dad to give me a Minolta 35 millimeter camera for graduation early, and went back.
It was love at first snap.
It was really good training because they published a paper every day and I had to have a picture in it. So I shot, developed, published, and so it was quick training. I thought I was an expert by the end of the summer.
And 40 years later, what do you know?
I'm still learning. I finally figured out I'm still learning.
4 days after graduation, C.C. headed to the Rocky Mountains to join his friend Marty Stouffer, a budding wildlife filmmaker. Marty would later create and host his popular PBS series, Wild America.
I'm Marty Stouffer. Even as a kid growing up in rural Arkansas, I was interested in photography. To me, it was some sort of magic.
Also there in the wilderness, C.C. would soon find his life's purpose in a chance encounter at Yellowstone.
Here was a Volkswagen van with Leonard LaRue, and he was a gray-haired old photographer. And he opened a suitcase, and he had like 1,000 rolls of film in it. And I had like 10 for the whole fall with me. I said, what do you got so much film for? And he says, I'm a professional nature photographer. I said, that's a job. I could do that. And so in late September of 71, I decided I was going to figure this out.
He became one of only a handful of professional nature photographers.
You know, there was National Geographic, photographers did go to a city one week and they'd go to a national park, but they weren't nature photographers, they were photojournalists. And there was about 10 or 15 guys like me and girls that were just starting off back then. And now there's thousands.
Success for Cece would take the same time and patience as getting the right shot. The first 2 years, he worked in the mountains with Marty.
And first on bighorn sheep and then on endangered species.
Luckily, expenses were low. Gas was 30 cents a gallon, and most nights they slept in a tent. He shopped his photos to magazines, but it was a year before he ever got one published, 2 years before he sold one in a gallery. Then a picture agent called, wanting to buy a photo of the Atchafalaya Basin. Cece didn't have one. He'd never taken pictures there.
But it intrigued me.
So he set out in that direction.
Drove to Fort Smith, got my childhood canoe, and came back. Never quit.
For the next 6 years, he photographed and, with Marty, made a film on the Atchafalaya. It's the largest wetland and swamp in the U.S. with 1,400,000 acres. It's nearly 20 miles wide and almost 150 miles long. While they were there, the Atchafalaya's entire ecosystem was threatened by a Corps of Engineers plan to dig the channel three times deeper.
Theoretically, to get a floodwater out quicker, but basically it would have dried up the basin,
thereby shriveling the lives, livelihood, and protection of people, wildlife, and all that flourishes here.
It's absolutely gorgeous and absolutely so important to the whole Gulf of Mexico, all of Louisiana, and really the whole world.
Cece's artistry through photography brought what was once misunderstood and mysterious into focus around the world. Saving our wetlands was seen in a new light. His work soon caught the eye of the head of National Geographic magazine.
She called me and said, "This looks like an interesting place, Cece. Why don't you come up and tell us about it?" So I flew to Washington and met with all these folks, showed them my film, and they hired me on the spot.
Wow.
I did 4 magazine stories for them, and that was the best one I did just because I love this place so much. And I spent a lot of time on it. And I think it polled as the second best story that year of all.
Next, he inked his first book deal, Atchafalaya, America's Largest River Basin Swamp. More than a dozen other books would follow. Those two emphasized the importance of nature and conservation through adventures that included platooning down the entire Mississippi River, discovering the Yucatan, and acclimating with alligators. Yet of all the spots he's been to, right here on the edge of Flat Lake is his favorite.
Flat Lake is just my favorite sunset spot in the world. You just get the cypress trees, the silhouettes, and the sunset behind them.
His photograph of it has circled the world on the bicentennial U.S. postage stamp. Fitting, he says, for such beauty.
Yeah, I'll never forget about the Atchafalaya. It's still my favorite place.
If you would like to sharpen your own photography skills, Cece conducts workshops throughout the year. You can head to his website for more information, cecelockwood.com. And still to come.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah, no!
We'll show you the crazy, funny lengths these folks went to raise money in the fight against cancer.
Then getting into the holiday spirit with Dr. Nick as Weekends with Whitney continues.
Maggio, the only way to go. Maggio Buick GMC, your satisfaction's our specialty. We really deliver on Fault River here in New Roads. Small town atmosphere, legendary service for over 60 years. Maggio, the only way to go. The only way to go, that's Maggio.
9-time winner of the prestigious Buick GMC Mark of Excellence Award.
Welcome back to Weekends with Whitney. The stage was set with fun, with comedy, with a bit of hilarity for the second Lip Sync Battle BR. And in its second year, it was bigger and bolder than ever.
Lip Sync Battles first started on The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. He challenged a celebrity guest to battle it out with him lip-syncing. It was instantly wildly popular and hilarious. Take a look.
Judge this is who is doing their best Milli Vanilli.
My name is Amanda Rose Andrews. And I'm reporting live here from the varsity.
It's a great cause. It's a lot of fun. I had no idea that the costumes and the amount of time that these people put into this production, it's awesome.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
We think this is very important. We do have many people at Theater Baton Rouge who have either lost their battle to cancer or survived cancer. Also, my grandmother lost her battle to cancer. And so I think it's really important to raise money to find out whatever cure we can possibly do to beat this disease.
For a great cause. My mother died of cancer 20 years ago, and the American Cancer Society was very vital in my family's life.
In Lip Sync Battle, taking home the championship belts, Team Brand!
They want to have 2 to 3 times as many teams next year. So if you'd like to get involved, grab some friends, some coworkers, and get in sync. For more information, go to crowdrise.com. And still to come, Dr. Nick on the spirit and spirits of the season.
Classic Hits 103.3, Scott Innes, welcome to the ride home. Put the seatbelts on, hug the babies when you get there.
Hey, Scott. Coffee, water, trash need emptying?
Hey, Chris, we're good, man. Thanks for checking in, though. Appreciate checking
good,
in.
Sure.
Yeah. And by the way, I'm playing Beth just for you today.
You too much, and I love you.
Oh, I
want to give you a kiss.
No, that's okay. Yeah, seriously. Sure. We're good. Seriously.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Scott Innes is back on 103.3 Classic Hits.
There are so many seasons and so many reasons to celebrate across South Louisiana that it seems like someone's always popping open a bottle of champagne or opening up the liquor cabinet. And sometimes we've probably all been there when it has caused chaos. So Dr. Nick is joining us to help us take our own temperature on that and of those around us.
My band played at the Irish Club's party a few weeks ago, and the alcohol was flowing. And I remember thinking of the movie in Terms of Endearment, where she said, you know, I'm not an alcoholic, I'm Irish. and that night at the Irish Club Fest, I was thinking, is this Irish or are we in Southeast Louisiana? Because I think it's true. I've traveled enough to know this is a very alcohol-induced culture.
Yes. Yes.
There's alcohol. There's always alcohol.
You're right.
Always alcohol.
And so if you're somebody who doesn't drink at all, it must be very difficult. But for those who do, there's always, we just need to keep restraint, perhaps.
Self-restraint. And people around us that will help us see our behaviors when we have hit the limit or gone beyond the limit. Because let's be realistic, Whitney, our personalities can change. Some of us become happier. Mm-hmm. Some of us become more fun. Some of us slur and get kind of
sloppy
and not quite sure, you know, where they're going. And then others can become mean.
You know, something that I see often is that a lot of people get really happy for a little while, but they're trigger happy on the anger button. It's like they can go from being the life of the party and having a great time to one person says one thing and it's atomic.
Yes. Well, it's interesting that you bring that up about the anger. I don't have anything to base this on, but I've often wondered if how we approach the alcohol, the mood that we're in when we approach the alcohol, okay? Because alcohol is a disinhibitor. It disinhibits. So if I go to drinking and I'm already in a bad mood, it's very possible that it's going to take me into a worse mood. I just wonder about these things. I've never been able to figure out why some people just become so mean and aggressive, but it's a disinhibitor. And I think part of the problem that we experience, particularly married couples, is that their anger can come out in alcohol.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That doesn't necessarily come out when we're sober. But I think we have to make some clarity, because there's this notion, and it may be true, that, well, the truth comes out when we've been drinking. Well, I don't know that that's completely fair. It's more of where we are at the moment.
Okay.
And what we're experiencing. Does that make sense?
Sure, because I've certainly said things before, you know, after a few drinks that I wouldn't have otherwise.
Or wouldn't pattern-wise. You don't have a pattern, I don't think, of becoming aggressive. We're looking for the patterns that can really be so harmful. And that's why, you know, in these seasons, wherever they are, be it Mardi Gras or Christmas or just an anniversary
football.
Or football,
sure.
Don't you notice that sometimes we find ourselves, oh, what's he or she going to be like today?
Yeah.
And then I ask myself, gosh, I hope... When I'm drinking, I'm with safe people like yourself who will say, Nikki, you've had enough.
Right.
Or you can't drink this anymore. Which you've done.
Oh, yeah.
But that's where the power of group. But see, that's kind of safe drinking. But I think we need to also talk about the fact that sometimes, Whitney, we have to accept the fact that we're powerless over alcohol and that our life has become unmanageable.
Oh.
Now, there's a problem drinking, there's a social drinking, but then there's really that I'm over the edge. I drink every weekend till I can't function.
Or I drink every
night, and because that's the only thing that will get me to sleep.
Mm.
Or I can't seem to get to work and even meet appointments because I've had too much to drink. The unmanageability is what we're looking at.
Okay.
And I think that's an important gauge for us to always be asking others and having, again, those people around us that help us. Our life seems to be unmanageable. I can't stop it. I can't find something else. I know that you told me once you started drinking some wine at dinner.
Yes.
But you caught it. And pardon me if I'm invading your personal space.
No, then it started to be a glass of wine tonight.
But you said to me, I caught it. See, that it didn't get to unmanageability.
Right.
Right.
But you know what? Also, I'll say, you know, my husband said something to me about it.
You did tell. But isn't that the power of a feedback system?
Yes.
Of someone who cares enough? And then you didn't get all defensive.
No, I listened.
You listened.
And I thought, I know that was hard for him to say. Because he doesn't, you know, usually do things like that. So I really did have to take a look at it.
Well, there's the power of, again, respectability of other people's space. Uh-huh. We don't want to, it's not about shaming someone.
Right.
You know, with any intervention, it's not about shaming. It's about trying to get people to see that they're powerless and unmanageable. And then lastly, I just want to give a word of like, please, there's nothing wrong with 12-step spirituality. It's very powerful. Even if you don't think you're powerless, you can still go and learn from it. Even if you don't, and I know AA people will be mad at me, just show up is the famous line of 12-step.
Yes.
Just show up.
I'm so impressed with some people who have quit drinking. And, I mean, it's not even a struggle not to drink anymore for them, but they go to weekly meetings.
And some go to daily until
wow.
they get a strong recovery under their belt. And if there's a group that you say, I don't like, find another one.
Okay, yeah, because you mentioned
Because there
that.
Are tons of AA groups and CODA groups and Al-Anon groups all over this city, and they're free.
Now, what if someone says, I don't like so-and-so in that group, and then they ruin it for me?
That's the addict.
Really?
That's the addict. Addicts don't have good boundaries. Thank you for bringing that up. That's the addict. See, the recovering person, or the person that wants to recovery, is basically going, saying, which is what 12-step says, I'm here for me. This is a selfish program. I'm here for my own recovery. It doesn't matter that I don't like you. You're here doing your recovery. Mm. And it says, take what you want, leave the rest. Do you hear all those wonderful...
I do.
There's no crosstalk. Why do you think there's no crosstalk? Because we don't want to engage.
Ah.
The point is that I say what's going on in me, you say what's going on, and there's no crosstalk.
Oh, I didn't know that.
There's no crosstalk.
I haven't been to a
meeting. I'm an AA fanatic. I think it's powerful stuff. I think it's powerful stuff. And particularly that in the terms of learning boundaries.
Oh.
Internal.
Boundaries.
Make sense?
Yes.
So that if all those people you despise, that just says keep going and keep focusing on you.
On you.
So I saw something that someone wrote this morning that said, I hate AA, I'm never going back. And I wrote back and I said, the power of 12-step is that it is a selfish program. You work your recovery the way you want to work it. And one of the great quotes is, again, what people say about me is none of my business. So you're going for... And he wrote back and thanked me because he said he would never go again. I said, that's telling you right there that you need to go. And say, I don't like this. Or not people. I don't like saying, I don't like people.
Sure.
But you can say, I'm uncomfortable with some of the talk, and maybe that's some of the issues I've got to work through.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's great stuff.
It's
great stuff. But now we've moved to the real alcoholic problem. I think
sure.
in Southeast Louisiana, we have to accept the fact that alcohol is a part of our culture.
Right.
And I think that's just a fact. But Whitney, you and I have both gone to parties and not had a drink.
Right.
Haven't we?
Not many.
We've been together where we didn't and yeah. still had fun. I mean, that's
oh,
all
absolutely.
I'm saying.
Absolutely.
People need to learn you can have fun. And if you got a habit, that's a little bit more towards the medication side.
Mm-hmm.
So just...
Don't medicate with it for sure. And drink something that you're familiar with. I have gotten in trouble before because they had some big punch or something and wasn't quite sure how much alcohol was in it. And somebody else was pouring my glasses. And I just don't usually drink hard liquor. I know exactly how much wine I can drink and
right.
maintain.
Right, and but you do have a good tolerance for wine.
Yeah.
I mean, just...
Right. But I do know that more than two or three glasses, if I haven't eaten, is
yes.
oh, more than yes. enough, you know?
But you know what I did, which has nothing to do with AA or 12-step?
Right.
I found a way to drink and have fun and not regret it. Water
between every drink.
Right? No, between every sip.
Oh,
He's too fisted. The other day I was having a drink and I had to have a sip, and then I would drink a good slug of water. But it was all so slow.
Mm.
You know who taught me that?
Who?
My alcoholic uncle on my mother's side.
No.
Said you always have a glass of water with the drink. Now we're talking like drinkers.
Hey, well, it didn't
but
help him.
You,
no.
It, Oh, he was in recovery. No, he stopped drinking.
Man, he must have been really down on him.
Be careful of alcohol, everybody. That's all. Right. It's a caution area.
Yeah.
It's a yellow light. Yeah, alcohol's yellow light.
Yellow light.
Fair enough.
And have somebody that will promise to be honest with you. And that if that person that you have a pack that somebody, if I've had too much to drink and I obviously don't realize it, you have to say it to me and I'm going to have to receive it.
Do you know what you did one night?
What?
Do you remember before we go?
Oh, tell me.
You were not happy with me. And you got up and you picked up that glass of wine or martini or whatever it was, and you said, you have had enough, my friend. And I was so angry. And the next day I was in tears with gratitude. Mm. That's a friend.
That is a friend.
That's a friend.
And it's hard to do.
And I'm not, again, trying to get into our relationship, but I know that was hard for you.
It was.
Because you probably saw the anger in my eyes.
I did.
And you were like, you've had enough.
Yes. And I was hoping you would thank me the next day.
I'm sure I did, because I was thinking about it.
You did.
Like, wow, but at the moment, it was hard.
But right.
Have friends around that will do that.
Right.
And
right.
And be receptive to it, because they care for you.
Because it's easy to embarrass yourself. And that's where I didn't want you to do that, you know.
Sure. So. And it's also easy to say, well, I'm not getting into their life. No, we need to get into each other's life that we care for.
Right. Protection. All right. Great to see you.
Be careful with alcohol.
That's right. Bye. We shall. More Weekends with Whitney coming up after this.
Atlas Foundation Repair, fixing your foundation problems for more than 30 years while preserving and protecting your trees.
Thanks for starting your New Year's with us here on Weekends with Whitney. We'll be back here again next week. Hope you are too. But until then, you can follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Or you can head to my YouTube channel, Weekends with Whitney, to catch this and more than 100 other shows. Wishing you the best New Year ever. This morning, we leave you with this.
What do you mean?